I think you all know what is going on. You know about the, well, you certainly know about the crisis. And I guess a lot of questions are being asked about mathematical finance, about what bonds do, what kind of role they played in this. And I think at this time, in particular, it's very important to have, you know, to be able to bring together, you know, our minds and our ideas, and to share them to solve the problems that we have, and to probably, you know, address the community and show us that, show them that, you know, this is what we do, and we are thinking about the problems, and we are trying to solve them. So there are several components to the Thalesians. I mean, first of all, we are a non-profit organization, and we are aiming to improve the public understanding of mathematical finance and to bring together people who work in this field. It's mathematical finance, computational finance, and finance in general, but the focus is on mathematical finance. And there are several projects that we're working on at the moment. I mean, there is a Wikipedia, if you like. I can't use this word because it's not a Wikipedia. Mathematical finance, and we have people contributing content to that, and it will be on the web. It will be publicly available. There is also, you might have heard of projects such as Boost, for instance, or Apache Foundation stuff. And they're all software projects where people can contribute, but they're peer-reviewed. I mean, there is a process for contributing software. And a lot of software is being rewritten, it's being regenerated. You know, you go to a different bank and you rewrite the same, I don't know, relation. And what we're trying to do, we're trying to perhaps do it well and allow people to contribute. And, you know, to have a standard, if you like, to have something that we can use as a standard. And these seminars is something where, you know, it's an opportunity to share ideas. And there will be a lot of speakers. I mean, we have quite a lot of people who have already confirmed that they are taking part in this. And Matthew is going to speak, my fellow Thalesian Matthew is going to speak shortly. Said is going to present a talk on foreign exchange, and Renee is going to talk about the Heston model, and we also have a few other speakers lined up. Claudia Albanese has agreed to present a talk, Brad Baxter, Bert Rustin, Linda White, a lot of people from the universities, a lot of well-known ones, and I'm not going to take your time any... the one thing that I wanted to say, I mean, we are paying for the room hire, and we are paying for the snacks, and it costs us basically roughly about £8 per person. I mean, it's voluntary. If you can contribute that would be great. That would just help us, you know, carry on in the future and organize more talks like this and more events. If you could, you know, chip in £8, that would be great. If you couldn't, well, it's basically entirely up to you. You can do it after the talk. You can just help us out. And, well, I mean, without further ado, I mean, I mean, this is the subject of the talk, and you know about the website as well. There is www.thalesians.com. Is there anything that I need to add? I think this is pretty much it, right? So, well, I'm not going to give you an abstract. I think Matthew is going to do it himself, and snacks will be served shortly. Thanks.
Well, thanks a lot for coming. I think the only sort of thing I wanted to add to, you know, to what Paul said on a general level is that, you know, this might seem like it's a very specific sort of talk, you know, and if you're not sort of in the field of commodities, then, you know, what does this matter? What do I care? And also, given the current sort of climate, how many people are actually sort of trading in this area? So I think, you know, there are some sort of stigmas about sort of, you know, digging into the old hat and pulling up these quant models and then talking about them for half an hour and then going home. In this particular case, I'm much more interested in, as Paul said, about leveraging the existing sort of software infrastructures out there and pulling it together. Okay, so I mean, there are a number of libraries that are already out there. I'm going to talk about a few others, which are open source libraries, which are developed by Lawrence Livermore and some of the other really big labs in the States. So these guys pour millions of pounds or dollars into development of software that gets used for scientific computing purposes. And I'd like to see some of that sort of pulled in and used in quantitative finance, because it's just, you know, it's a diamond there waiting to be picked. So this talk is some sort of work that I did when I was at Stanford, and feel free at any point in time to sort of intervene So let's sort of give an outline of what I'm going to talk about. So what are what is sort of the pricing infrastructure for spread options? This is your core classical math finance. A little bit about the sort of forward models they use, the term structure models. So if you've read Brigio and Mercurio and term structure modeling, you'll know this very well. Similar sort of concept is used in commodities modeling, and you know the work of Gurman in particular is very relevant here. So I mean, just a quick show of hands. I mean, how many people have read Mercurio? How many people have read sort of Dominic Brigio's interest rate modeling book? Does anyone know what I'm talking about? Okay, that's good. So I won't spend too much on this really, because it's sort of textbook stuff, it's there just for sort of more as a sort of as a placeholder. But what I want to talk about is this collaboration I've been working on, and I think that's interesting. And then just sort of wrap it up with a few numerical examples. So this is supposed to be fun. It's not supposed to be me just talking down to you for the next half an hour. It's really supposed to be just sort of jostling up ideas, thinking about things in different ways. And that's why at some point I really want to be thinking all the way through, how does this stuff work in times of a crisis? You've got jumps in the data. Does this calibration stuff really work? Okay, so I mean, that's the big question here. And I don't have the answer to that. I can just give my own sort of ideas on this. Okay, so a bit of background for anyone who's sort of interested in commodity derivative modeling. So when we talk about commodities, we're talking about precious metals, we're talking about energy, oil, natural gas, electricity, and sort of the models which we've been looking at, you generally don't bother modeling the spot. Okay, you tend to look at the forward curve itself. And the reason for that is that most of these sort of models are run by banks to estimate their risk profiles. So if you're in a bank and an energy company comes along to you and says, I need natural gas to power my station and I'm going to produce electricity at the end of it. The only problem is that when I buy natural gas, if I want to buy natural gas right now, it's a peak price, and it's going to take me a while to produce the electricity. And so how much natural gas you buy and how much electricity you supply if you're a power company depends on the market, depends on the market value of the electricity futures and also on the market value of your input into it. It could be coal, it could be natural gas. So you've got a hedging problem. Okay? A power plant is nothing but just a hedge fund. It has to buy something, it has to sell something, it has to keep itself hedged. And so one of the big candidates for this, and energy is a massive area, I mean, forget what's happening in the economy, we all need energy, and so there are sort of fundamental economic reasons why these sort of products are useful. And what I would say there is that they come to the banks and they say, okay, give me some kind of structured product which will help me hedge out the differences in electricity and natural gas prices. So very interesting times right now in the energy markets. They're going haywire. You've got all sorts of OPEC conflicting interests. You've got Gazprom. You've got it becoming increasingly cheap to sort of freight and shuttle back an energy from the States. So this is a really interesting time for commodities and energy in particular. So I'm talking about seasonality in this talk, and I'm talking about natural gas. Okay, natural gas and heating oil are the main sort of seasonal ones. Why? Because, well, when it gets cold in winter, everyone needs natural gas to heat up their houses, and so it pushes up the price. And so, really, the main sort of area, main use here is in credit and market risk modeling. So if you're a bank, you need to work out how much you could lose over at the time horizon that the energy companies enter into the trade with. You've got to work out what your worst case scenario is and model that. That's why we're looking at forwards and not just spots. We're really interested in time horizon. And for quantitative purposes, most of the techniques are borrowed from Heath Jarrow Morton framework. Okay, so that was a sort of precursor to the LIBOR market model. And anyone who knows about HGM will understand a bit more what I'm talking about. So this is really sort of, if you really want to trace my steps and sort of go down to, you're interested in going down this road yourself, then here's some of the literature. And it sort of broadly sort of summarizes the sort of the sort of main sort of points in this talk.
So, I mean, these slides will be available on the website.
Okay, so let's start with sort of more formally what the statement of the problem. So the problem is, I want to know what the price of an option is on, I want to know what the risk neutral price of an option is on two tradables, one forward and another forward, okay? This is a very generic framework. So just remember, forwards on, say, electricity, forwards on gas, okay? I'm interested in the difference, the spread. That's where the spread comes from. And so within this definition, I'm capturing what is the risk neutral price of the spread, struck at a certain price K, okay? So we've got two things to consider here, okay? Beyond the standard Black-Scholes or the plain vanilla option, we've got the spread, and we've got different maturities here, T1 and T2, okay? So the option is struck at time T, but these forwards can expire beyond that, okay? One, I could be striking an option that's going to be expiring in, say, 1 year, and then my electricity price might be expiring in 2 years, and my natural gas forward might actually be expiring in 3 years. Okay, so there's a couple, there's an actual level of complexity here. For anyone who's doing math finance, you'll know about sort of what I mean by this. I'm just saying really that it's a conditional expectation on the filtration. Okay, that is, we're assuming that the risk neutral price is conditional on everything we know up to that point in time, and that's the notation I'm using. And that's very standard stuff. So the main point to be clear on here is at this stage, this is a spread option, and this is the way I'm going to price it. So here's an example, just exactly the same as I have a form, the discounting factor here, take us back to time t. So tau now is the difference in the time that the trade was struck, big T, and the current time is t. So tau is how much further ahead in time that option will expire. And I'm assuming, and they do this in commodities, and I think it's a bit silly, but they keep the interest rate fixed. In some cases, that's not a good thing to do. But it's the simplest case, and it's just worth sticking with it for now. So with a heat rate option, I almost told you everything you needed to know about it. This is the power plant. But there's one other tweaking parameter as well. That's the efficiency of the power plant. So you take the price of the power, or electricity, and subtract it from this factor times the natural gas. So for a very inefficient plant, this is going to be about 0.01. For a very efficient one, it's going to be about 0.2. And the main thing to say here is that normally you have to guess what that is. It's not actually that easy to work out. And all of this sort of data is provided in sort of really patchy ways. We're not going to find this on the exchange. On sort of indices. Okay, so that's one product within this. That was a heating rate option, or it's called a spark spread. Okay, the difference between power and a natural gas, or it could be power and oil. There is also another type of instrument which is traded much more frequently. Okay, so the heat rate option, which I showed you before, is a very bespoke thing. That's when an energy company comes to a bank and says, I need a bespoke, structured portfolio. However, calendar spreads are done on exchanges. So if you go to the Brent exchange, or NYMEX, they'll be trading these things, calendar spread options, okay, with commodities. So in some sense, these are more interesting because they occur more frequently. Now the only difference here now is that the underlying, the forward indices are the same. Okay, before I had a power and I had a natural gas. Now we're assuming that the forward, the underlying of the forward is the same. Okay, so it could just be oil, a certain grade of oil, but the time is now different. So why do you want to do that? Why do you want to trade and measure the spread between a forward contract which expires in 3 years and a forward contract which expires in 5 years? Okay, so I'm a trader. I'm going to go long, say T1 is less than T2. I'm going to go long the shorter forward contract. What I mean by shorter is expire nearer in time. And I'm going to go short on a longer dated expiring forward contract. Okay. And the reason being is that they're trying to capture skew in the vol. Okay. So as you go out further in time, the vol is diminishing. And so depending on whether you go long a call or you go short a put, you can profit from the way that the skew is diminishing. Okay, so it's a way of kind of exploiting, making money off the skew. Okay, and I'm not going to talk very much about that, but that's sort of enough to get the feeling that of what this is all about. Blank slide. Okay. So what's the formula they use to solve this? Yes, you don't need to sort of do any heavy duty numerics at this stage to solve this, I'm afraid. There is just an analytic expression. Is it any good? The answer is no. But it works sort of in a very mysterious way. The first thing to do to solve that that expression for the price of the calendar spread where it is to rejig the equation slightly and now introduce another variable f, which is a ratio of the two forward contracts plus the expiry. When you do that, you can then write the Python equation in this form, okay, where that's the normal distribution with your D1s and your D2s. And I learned something useful from Huey Weistrop. I don't know if you know Huey Weistrop. He runs the Mass Finance of DE Exchange. He's a very interesting guy. He's a professor at Mass Finance. And he's made tons of money as well. But he says, normally when you see in a textbook, you have parameters for Black-Scholes equation, D1 and D2. And the problem is, it's like, which one? D1 is the one with the minus in? Is it the one with the plus in? Well, the good thing is, if you just remember it's D plus and D minus, then you know you don't have to remember the plus and the minus, but that's just a really small little thing. So what's the interesting thing on this slide? And I think that the thing to point out here is that we're assuming a martingale framework, okay? So we're assuming, actually, that this thing here behaves as a martingale. That means that's a sort of requirement for essentially the first fundamental theorem of finance. Okay. So and then the second fundamental theorem of finance, if you remember, says, well, actually, how many different martingale measures are there? And if there's more than one, then it means you have an incomplete market. Commodities are incomplete, so you're going to have more than one measure, which pins down the actual price. But we're going to assume it's a martingale. Okay. You need to do that. Otherwise, you violate the first fundamental theorem of finance, and we're back to the drawing boards and you know the days before, sort of, I guess, Black-Scholes and that stuff. So this is the equation now. This is your equation. So notice that there's only a contribution from this Brownian term. Okay. So now the stochastic differential of that forward price, right, or this term here, this new completely sort of it's just introduced for convenience here, has no drift term, it's only the stochastic part, okay, that makes it the martingale under that particular measure, okay. And when you have this martingale framework, you can then use this formula, okay. So there's lots of, you know, if you start going through it, there's lots of really iffy things in all this, and it goes way beyond the sort of normal sort of critique of Black-Scholes. And there have been many attempts to sort of improve on this, but it's like anything. When you try and actually fix it and do it properly, you end up with this horrific mess of an equation, and it's not really worth it most of the time. I mean, it's not a very precise statement, I know, but... and then you have this variance term here, which is just the sort of combination of the two. So you have to measure what this is.
So you model both forwards as log normal?
Yeah, that's right. So yeah, so this is assumed to be log normal distributed.
How's F1 and F2 are log normal, right?
I mean, yeah, that's right. So that's how. Yeah, so that's a crucial thing. F has to be log normally distributed in this framework. Okay, so what are we doing at this point? Well, I said a little bit about the closed form expression for pricing spread options. That's Kirk's formula. If you've got two contracts that are correlated, okay, and remember there was a little correlation term here, I didn't say anything about that. There's a row of correlation. So these things are correlated, of course. So correlated forward prices, and one and two here to say that it's general enough, they can be different, have different underlyings. But I haven't actually said anything about the dynamics yet of this. Okay, I mean, I've said very crudely that it has to fit within this sort of pricing framework. And that's where the sort of story gets interesting, okay? Because if I just wrote down that equation there, okay, how are you going to capture the seasonality in the trade? How are you going to capture what's really happening with the data? So this is just a formal framework, okay? This comes out of the Martingale framework. But then there's the reality. So, and I'll talk about that, though, so don't worry if you don't understand. So here are two, so I've plotted the mean, and I've plotted the standard deviation, the vol of the forward price. And this is time to expiry on the bottom. Okay, so once we get out here, this is very long. And this is where it's very, very close to expiring. I've just taken a snapshot of the data. And what we see is both the seasonality, roughly sort of, you know, that's what, 5 months, that's about 17 a year. There's annual seasonality, both the mean and the vol. Okay, that's kind of to be expected, really. When the market price increases, there's also maybe a shortage of the supply, pushes the price up, things become very volatile. So seasonality affects both the volatility and the mean price. So one of the sort of, I think, in my knowledge, the only model that really sort of captures this within this forward framework, okay? If you're familiar with Schwartz, long Schwartz, you know, what the long start from Schwartz, you know, he's kind of gods. Schwartz came up with a model, but it was all sort of done on the spot price, it wasn't the forward price, okay? So this is a model which Orakhov and Gaman came up with for capturing the seasonality, okay? And the seasonality is captured in this function, okay? And it's a function of the expiry time. So in other words, if I expire in December, and it's a natural gas contract, then that's when I'm gonna have a peak seasonality, because it's cold and I need to heat up the house, and that's when the market price pushes up. And if that T were to fall in the month of June, then the seasonality function would be at its trough. Very crudely, I mean, it's more just a sinusoidal wave, as you saw. And then there's this sort of horrible sort of thing that I haven't talked about, convenience yield. And this is very much a sort of a terminology which is under debate. Do you have convenience yields? What are they? We don't see in the market, traders don't know about them. But convenience yield is something that sort of appeared from economics literature, I think. Sort of Farmer and French, if you're sort of familiar with the economics, if you're going back to the 1950s, 60s, they were looking at infantry and coming up with economics models to model infantry. And they came up with this idea of convenience yield. And so it's found its way in really as a way of, as an extra variable, which sort of basically represents the demand, the sort of, you know, how much there is stored of your particular commodity. Right, so yeah, I've plotted here a seasonality function, and I've plotted here what this convenience yield looks like. And I've done this in retrospect on the model, which I'm just about to show. So don't worry if you don't know where that comes from. Right, okay, so remember we had this forward price, okay, it was a ratio of those two forward prices. Just go back to that slide so that everyone's on the same page. So these are the real tradable forwards, okay? That was the forward you see on the market. Natural gas, you know, power or something else. And then we came up with this sort of factorized, well, this ratio to F. Okay, so keep that one in mind. Then we had this conversion from sort of market, barely recognizable market sort of variables to internal variables, okay? There are three internal variables in this model. Seasonality, gamma, the stochastic convenience yield, and this thing, F bar. And F bar represents the average of the curve. Okay, so if you've got a term structure, then F is the mean level, okay, of the curve. And that's actually not such a bad thing. So you might want to measure not only how much a forward curve tilts, but how much it moves around. So you've already got that sort of first moment of the curve. So we're going to construct this curve now, and it's all on that paper. Right. And we're now going to introduce some dynamics for these two intrinsic variables. Okay. We're going to have a mean reverting wall for the mean value of the curve. Okay, so this describes now how that mean value is, of the curve, the average level, is moving around. Okay, it's got a noise term, and then it has this mean inversion tendency. And we're going to introduce another equation for the convenience yield. Okay, again, this one has reverts around a null mean, and this is the sort of elasticity, how much it sort of fluctuates about. And then we've now got the volatility of the convenience yield. Okay, again, a term structure. Okay, that's the interesting bit to calibrate. Okay, because now we've got to calibrate a vol surface, but it's the vol of a convenience yield. It's not the vol of a fluid. So there are also two Brownian motions, two correlated Brownian motions. So if you were, if you showed up on a Monday morning and someone said to you, okay, look, God has just given you a model to write for our traders. How are you going to calibrate this model? What are you going to do? You know, are you just going to sort of look at the market data, just do some averaging, try and sort of work out what these variables are by applying them from this equation? Or are you going to do something else? And I guess I was lucky because that's something else when I worked on this problem. So this is a problem which came to me when I was working in a bank, and I wasn't very happy with the way they were solving it. And so if you put all the pieces together, that original forward, that ratio of the forwards, is now written as a two-factor stochastic equation. There's one Brownian motion, there's two Brownian motions. And then there are these terms, and they're correlated. Well, it's strictly in what's called a real world measure, these things would be independent, but they're not. Because we're working in a risk neutral measure. Okay? So this model was designed actually in what's called a real world measure. That's what you get if you back it out from the data. But we need a pricing measure which is consistent, doesn't introduce arbitrage into the price of options. So we have to bear in mind always, are we in the real world measure or are we in the risk neutral pricing measure? If you're not dealing with options, I don't think you need to worry about the risk neutral or any sort of derivative of security. But if you're in the game of trying to back out what option prices are, you've got to watch this like a hawk. Okay, otherwise you're introducing arbitrage to your model. And no, that's no good. So here are the intrinsic dynamics. These are the risk-neutral intrinsic dynamics. Risk-neutral intrinsic dynamics can't have any drift in them. Okay? They have to be martingale. Otherwise, you've got essentially a problem where you're not in this martingale framework. When you've got a two-factor model, you have to think very carefully about how you're going to get these terms. Okay, so I've shown you two almost sort of conflicting slides here. Okay, I showed you one where you were under a real world measure, and you can write down this thing. There's no stars on W's, and there it's assumed that the universes are independent. But when we're under, there's a mistake there. I should say dependent. These two are dependent, okay? So they are correlated. So excuse that. So the crucial thing is, are we in the risk neutral dynamics or are we under real world dynamics? And that's the hard part, sort of conceptually as well, because it's just something you can just sort of write code to kind of work out. For me, I found that quite difficult. I still sometimes I think it's just a load of nonsense. So here. Let's go over this in more detail. So, how am I going to get the average of the futures price? Well, you could actually just do it very crudely. You could look at all the consecutive periods on the curve, going up year by year, and say, okay, what's my average over the year? So if you had, for convenience, 12 months, then you could work out what the annual of the logarithm of that forward curve. I say it's a forward, it's really a ratio of those two forward curves. And I can work out very crudely what the seasonality is. if I have multiples of 12 months. This is all done on a monthly basis. And then, using that equation, which is here, I can then imply what my convenience yield is. I know what these things are, I work that one out from there. I know what that one is, given that historical data. And I estimate what that is, seasonality. Okay. It's probably not the only way you can do it, and you have to be a little bit careful when you're not, haven't got multiples of 12, so you have 18 months, when you've got a 22-month date, and you've got to make adjustments for that. And it's in that paper, which... Right, so the interesting part is leading towards the calibration, okay? And the way that they calibrate is by matching the covariance matrices of the forward models. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the covariance matrix of the date, the covariance of the data, and then I'm going to map it to the theoretical expression for the covariance of the model. And that's generally how they do things. Okay, now there's a couple of really big problems there which I'm going to sort of identify. So the gain of calibration is to minimize the least squares minimization of these two things. And that's what they call calibration. And I don't think that you'll be overly impressed with it, which is partly why I'm showing it to you. I should have had a few more slides here. I mean, just sort of giving a bit more background, because what I'm talking about on the next slide is actually my research. I mean, at this level, I mean, if how much are you kind of understanding? Is this sort of okay, or sort of am I annoying people here by sort of talking so insanely at a too low level? I mean, it's all right. I mean, just carry on. Shall I just throw you in the deep end? Okay. So the covariance matrix is this. The covariance matrix model is this. And notice that I'm constructing the covariance matrices not from the forward prices. So I could have just plugged in the covariance of, where is it? This one here. I could have plugged in the covariance of this. Okay, and so I know I'm going to fit the joint expectation of DFT to the deltas or the returns of the forwards or the covariance of the data series. I could have done that. Problem with that is I don't capture the seasonality properly. So the thing to do is to compute what the theoretical covariance is of these stochastic convenience yields, okay? Because they're supposedly removed, they don't have any seasonality in them. Okay. So when I'm taking the covariance, I'm assuming I've got a normal distribution here, or a log normal distribution. Now if there's seasonality involved, I'm in trouble, okay? Because I'm no longer going to have all the requirements needed for the data for this to be a log normally distributed variable, because it's got seasonality in it, the sequence itself might be stationary, and you need to calibrate, you need your data sequence to be stationary. So that's sort of drifting into all stats. But the big idea here, and I don't expect anyone to understand this, because I wouldn't understand this on the first read. But the big idea, essentially the big picture here, is to stop using black box routines for calibration, okay? The temptation is point to say, oh, I've got a least squares problem. Right, oh, I'll use MATLAB. Oh, I'll use some other software. Give me a number, I'm done. But that's a very American way of doing things. You know, where you just sort of throw computers at the problem and there's no thinking involved. And I prefer to go down the sort of, I guess, My sort of hero is a guy called Fadiva, who's a Russian linear algebra expert, and he works out these amazing linear algebra routines. He didn't have a computer, and it's still, you know, he's the mind that sort of crafted modern linear algebra routines that you see in all these MATLAB libraries and stuff like that. But the point being here is that you can actually be clever about this and do something a bit more careful. You could say, okay, I've got my matrix, it's positive definite, it's metric. And what am I going to do? I mean, how do calibrations work? I mean, what do they normally do? And how can you instead of just giving a routine a least squares problem, giving it to the computer and saying, okay, come on, give me back the answer. I need to go for lunch, hurry up. You can say, okay, what type of problem is this? You know, what type of calibration problem do I have? Do I know the limits on the parameters I want to solve for? So in this calibration problem, remember, I want to solve for something. I want to solve for this convenience here of volatility surface. I might have 36 points, I might have 60 points, I might have 90 points on that surface. I've got to calibrate the model by determining what this curve is. Okay, you can't see it, it's a curve, but it's a curve. I want to find the curve. The problem is that the algorithm really, really crucially depends on what you plug in as an initial starting value. And it's a little bit like Newton's method. If you don't start close to the solution, then you could just wiggle off and you'll never find it. So the idea is here is that we know a little bit about the problem anyway. We know roughly what we're looking for on a volatility surface. We know that it can't just go up to infinity, you know, and then come back down again. We know that it can't go below zero. We also know that it has to have some sort of shape. So the idea is to reduce the parameter space to something more sensible, that everyone can say, okay, I believe that. It also makes your algorithm more robust, because most calibration routines will just fire off and give you back anything. And it's your job just to sort of randomize them and collect back and just say, oh, I'll have that one, please, as a solution. Most calibration routines don't give you back a unique answer, but for global optimization problems. This is a global optimization problem. It's high dimensional global optimization problem. It could be 60 points in that curve, in which case it's a 60 dimensional problem, could be 90 if it's a 9 dimensional rate. So the point is that we've got a 90 dimensional, we've got 90 points in the curve, 90 dimensional global optimization problem solved. No one knows how to solve global optimization problems to give you a unique answer. It's not even sure there is a unique answer. So how can you restage the problem a little bit and get out the answer you want? Simple. You put in what the limits are on that. So you have to guess roughly what should be sensible limits. Okay, so that's point one, okay, guessing the limits. The second thing is, how can you kind of rejig things a little bit to make your life easier? And so the second piece of the information is my data smooth? I mean, is this problem, when I say is this data, I mean is this problem, is this equation smooth? Can I differentiate it? Yes, I can. I mean, okay, you've got, you can differentiate it in the covariance matrix, because you've already got rid of these terms when you've taken the covariance matrix. You just replace these with delta t's and rows. So you're then left with this. If it's smooth, if your problem, the model you're fitting is smooth, exploit that smoothness. Okay? And so the second point I want to make is to use a gradient-based optimization approach. Okay? There are a lot of all sorts of different routines out there. There's various sort of algorithms that just splurge out numbers. So look for smoothness in the data, because then you can take gradients of the problem. And gradients give you a very sort of fast-tracked way of searching the crucial directions of the problem. And so that's almost what I've said. I mean, it's almost everything I want to say. The third point is, how can you sort of get these gradients to be in the right way, in the directions you want them to? So you're not just searching here, there, and everywhere. You're actually searching in a meaningful way. And so what you can do is just diagonalize your matrix and get out this, these are matrices here. These are orthogonal matrices. It's just a straightforward diagonalization of a positive symmetric, a positive definite symmetric matrix. And then you've got now a row of positive values along this. So it's just the matrix with only entries along its principal diagonal component. There's a positive entries, and those represent the eigenvalues of the matrix. Okay. So the idea now is that you bump, or the algorithm bumps in its search for a solution. It bumps the eigenvalues, and those eigenvalues are, in the language we've heard of this, called principal components. So what you're trying to do is meaningfully perturb the data in directions which make sense. Now those principal components, i.e. the eigenvalues in this thing, actually correspond to something meaningful. You can interpret it. The principal component, vaguely speaking, can be interpreted as the parallel shift of the curve. The second component can be as a potential as a curvature, as a change of gradient. Second, curvature, third, the moments going on and on. So these eigenvalues do actually give you some sort of meaningful interpretation. So that's been my approach, and if you try and get a black box solver to do that, you can't. Okay, you have to somehow work into the code and find out how you can speed things up. So that's just a little bit of mumble jumble for what I just said, or actually something much more precisely for what I just said. And I'm going to do show you some results of tests or things that I think are good things to do to check for when you're calibrating code, if you really want to do it the best way. And I'm going to tell you about this in the library called OPPlus. It's free. It's developed by Lawrence. It's either Lawrence Livermore or it's Oak Ridge, but I think it's Lawrence Livermore. But anyway, they have, it's Sandy.
There we go.
This guy, C.T. Kelly, has written a really good book, and I think that's also on his webpage, about iterative methods for optimization. And most of his work sort of got embedded in this library, OPPlus. And if you're really into sort of trying out high performance computer libraries, this is really built for supercomputers who are doing very, very large sort of nuclear code and that sort of thing. But it has all the features you need to sort of to tweak your optimization, and I'm going to show you some results. So a bit of stats sort of confirm that what we're actually doing makes some sort of sense based on our data. And also, your calibration is only good, or your results are only going to be as good as your data. So you need to have an estimate of how good your calibration can be based on how good your data is. So that's why I'm sort of saying, look, we need to kind of set our expectations here before we do the calibration. Are we expecting calibration to be super amazing, or do we actually expect it to be sort of a little bit rubbish because the data isn't very good? So the sort of things you do on your data, so I've taken natural gas futures, and what I'm doing now is I'm plotting a histogram. I am looking at autocorrelation, and I'm looking at the lags in autocorrelation. So I did all this using R, the stats package, which is, prefer that to MATLAB. And so you can look at the quantiles, and you can start to look at the amount of information held in each principal component. So remember what I said, when you rotate your covariance matrix, you then got along your diagonal elements the principal components. And normally, for sort of commodities, the first two or three are big. They're sort of, 0.4, 0.5, 1.2 or something. And it tails off very quickly. Okay. And then what you get in those other eigenvalues is you're going to have, say, 30 points in your curve. You're going to have maybe three or four non-trivial eigenvalues. The rest of them are just noise. Unfortunately, that's not true for every asset class. Some asset classes, they have more eigenvalues, more principal components. But what this graph is telling you is that if I just remove everything but the data cross projected onto the first principal component, how much of the data have I got originally? So you can see already that off the time series, sort of 0.92, or 92.5% of it, is just parallel shifts. Okay, and I've done that by just projecting onto the first principal component. See, that's the eigenvector corresponding to that first eigenvalue of that matrix. And I can do the same thing. So now let's include the first two principal components, the first three, four, five, six. And you quickly see that you're not getting very much gain if you include those other eigenvalues. So if you're in the sort of business of, well, how many eigenvalues I need to keep, and how many can just throw away because they're just noise, this type of plot gives you an idea. So you're trying to justify throwing things away. You want to somehow filter the data a little bit to make the calibration a bit faster as well. But you don't want to filter it so much you end up calibrating to a different problem. So not much more, because the food is there and it must be getting cold, and I'm talking, the food's getting cold, so sort of a bit of a moral dilemma there. So seasonality so I've just sort of caught some markets. These are all done in New York on NYMEX. So this is Connecticut, northeastern peak price. So all those feeds are going out to New York from Houston, power plants along the way. Interesting aside, all the sort of power plants that run in sort of Baltimore and it sort of feed from New York State are just being bought by Goldman Sachs. So that's sort of an interesting sort of observation.
I think Goldman Sachs is all trying to take over the world and sort of get that rear, get that hub. So one of the major sort of energy companies is sort of responsible for this sort of network and all the pricing. So this is electricity, that's gas, and it's different in the UK as well. So depending on geography, you'll get different sort of seasonality functions. And then I sort of just plotted the correlation between natural gas and electricity needs, convenience yields, okay, going out the term structure. Okay, so there's quite a lot of correlation. It's pretty noisy, but it's a lot more correlation as you expect in close to expiry forwards, and that's sort of shown in the convenience yields. So you've got to measure all these things, and these results are sort of calibrating the convenience yield volatility. That's what it looks like, this convenience yield of your term structure for this particular problem. So it does have this, you know, it does have a bit of structure there, but it's, you know, it's not, it's really just decaying very quickly. Again, that's for natural gas and electricity, so they're pretty similar, although they're very different order of magnitude as well. Pretty similar, actually. I guess, interestingly, electricity seems to have a smaller community than you sort of expect to be. Well, I think there's a reason for that, which is sort of a bit of flaw in the methodology as well. But you notice in that model I didn't include jumps, and a lot of people include jumps in the model as well. So if now I take this Opt++ library, okay, and I want to work out how good all these different routines are. So I just took this routine, and I have a whole load of different gradient-based and non-gradient-based algorithms. Basically, state-of-the-art optimization algorithms are there. To my knowledge. And you can add constraints, and you can rotate the vector in the matrix, like I said, so you're just bumping the eigenvalues, perturbing the eigenvalues to sort of help you get to your solution faster. And so what I've done is sort of each color represents one of the different algorithms. And I think the labels look later on the slide, but it's sloppy with it. This is one of the things where it's probably easier if I just point out the best one, and then if everyone wants to talk about this, then I can just scale down. If you're an optimization expert, then this is going to be really interesting. If you're not interested in optimization, this is going to be pretty dull. And so I will just give you a sort of high-level overview. So this is the number of gradient evaluations, and then I've just done 10 successive trials. I'm trying to work out how many gradient evaluations and how many functional evaluations each sort of algorithm does. See, now if you don't use a gradient-based algorithm, you don't have, obviously, a gradient evaluation. That costs time, computational time. But your algorithm may not be as good, and it has to do more iterations to converge, and therefore more function evaluations. So although these plots are really small and you probably can't see them, what I will point out is that if I use, say, for example, a gradient projection algorithm has the line, so this one up here, it's just 10 independent successful trials, each one rolling on. That one took around about 14,000 on average sort of function evaluations, that's iterations to conversions of I think 10 to the minus 8. And so this is a gradient projection algorithm. And it still does a lot of gradient evaluations as well. So, you know, it's not very competitive. So there's an example of a gradient projection algorithm, which isn't very interesting. It's not very competitive. But if you take something like a quasi-Newton interior point method, then you can see that, you know, sort of down here, it actually converges very quickly. And it has the added benefit. It doesn't need to do that many gradient evaluations. It's all doing gradient evaluations. So the point being here is that there are lots of different optimization approaches, and I like this one, which is called the BFGS. It's by, I can't remember what that acronym stands for, but it performs really well, and a lot of thought has gone into it, and it's one of the sort of simpler algorithms. So this is what happens when you open up the box on your MATLAB routine. A lot of this sort of research went into that. A MATLAB usually just sort of picks whatever it wants. You don't get to choose that. So I like to be able to control things more and choose which algorithm I want. And I mean, there's lots more data here about sort of independently algorithm about, again, going back to these principal components. You know, I showed you that plot already, how much information is contained when you keep successive principal payments. Now, if you just, you can see, if you sort of back it, sort of work out what the variance is of each of the principal components. So you can see that the, you know, the sort of the first, this is the variance, and this is the variance of the community. So that's gas, that's electricity. And the point being is that, you know, it's quite interesting to look at how the different principal components how much variance there. That variance is again just how big the eigenvalue is. So I'm just giving you a bit more information, but with the term structure this time. So I guess what to take home from that is that you can get most of what you need by just keeping two or three principal components, and you can keep the general sort of shape of the variance surface. Okay. I mean, of this, you know, volatility term structure, and really going up to sort of 30N in this case. That's what happens if you keep all 30. You don't filter the data at all, and then the calibration problem gets really, really horrible. It's a little noisy. But you know, that's what you gain essentially, and the scale is, this isn't a log scale. Okay, that's the most important thing. This isn't a log scale, so you know, you're going from minus 10 to say minus 5. It's base 10, and this is minus 10 and minus 6. So it's a very small gain, really, by increasing the number of items. And it's, again, I'm trying to justify filtering the data. So I think that's an important aspect, because you're playing a game here where you've got to filter the problem slightly to get the calibration algorithms to work. You don't want to filter it so much that, you know, you end up sort of losing all the interesting data. And there are some people that think, tell me that data is gold. You don't touch it. You don't filter it. And there are other people that say, well, you know, you live in the real world here, you've got to get numbers out quickly, you don't filter the data, algorithms are just going to sort of hit some major sort of stability problems. And that's what a heating rate core price looks like. Strike, so there's a you know, sort of three-dimensional surface now, because you've got sort of, on this axis, time to maturity. And although you can't see it, it's sort of not the best view, it's sort of, you know, it's quite sort of undulating close to time to maturity. As you get close to the expiry, you know, the price tends to become a bit more volatile. And clearly, you know, so it does have an interesting element. You can just make out the sort of seasonal effects as well, those little ridges. Again, it's not the best plot. You know, shamefully, I don't know about that, but there's. So remember I said about filtering out the data, you know, chopping off the principal components, just taking two or three. And for the volatility term structure, on that log scale that I showed you, you know, we're sort of talking very small amounts, you know, sort of, yeah, that's base 10, you know, it's between minus 10 and say minus 7, that's pretty small. But what's the interesting thing is to say, okay, well, let's not just look at the forward curve, but let's actually look at the heating rate option and say how much the truncation affects the heat rate option price, and then start looking at the deltas and all the Greeks. Because then that's interesting, okay? Because then you can quantify how much of an effect filtering the data has on the Greeks and on the option price surface. Okay, so surface here, because we've got strike and we've got time to maturity. And, you know, I'm just picking various different strikes and various different times to maturities. So that's what happens. So here I've got just three principal components. I only chose the three eigenvalues. I've chopped off the rest, and I essentially just reconstructed my theoretical. I reconstructed my empirical covariance matrix just using three principal components. And what we see when we look at the heating rate core price is that, you know, the area is definitely that's sort of. Now we're sort of talking about some serious numbers here. You know, it's not 10 to the minus 10 anymore. We're actually talking about a sizable effect. So the problem here is that you may want, if you're working only with pricing forward curves, and tracking forward curves, truncating is fine. But you've got to be very careful. And in a way, this is a measure of how good your calibration algorithm has to be. Remember, your calibration algorithm has to fit the product you're pricing it to. And if your product is very sensitive to truncation and calibration errors, then you're going to be
then you can start to quantify that and say, okay, well, anyone who's trading, you know, in the short term here, you might want to be a little bit aware, you know, that the algorithm is producing a small amount of error. Model risk. So you've got now to somehow incorporate model risk into it. Okay, the model is not giving you the right answer. And again, you know, this is using 5 bits components, still, you know, a factor of 10 smaller, but, you know, I wouldn't sort of push that under a carpet either. Yeah, and that's with 10. Again, we're starting to sort of, you know, drop down to, you know, 10 to the minus 3. And that sort of pretty much wraps me up. So I think it's time to eat, drink, and I've probably talked too long, so sorry about that. But the key point, the take-home message here is, really, from the point of view of if you're sort of into the modeling side of things, then you've got to be very careful about capturing structure in your data. In other words, seasonality. Okay, you can't just blindly do the calibration algorithm. You've got to do some stats, and you've got to look for the structure in the data. And in this case, we have seasonality. You've then got to be very careful about how you measure your error. What is your going to be your choice of measure, you know, of error? Is it just going to be that least squares, you know, measure of error that you learn in high school? Or are you actually going to think about this and say, okay, I guess the most important thing here is that, which I didn't show, is Greeks. Okay, because if it's showing up on the price surface, that's even worse for the Greeks. Okay, they're even more sensitive to that error. So the point being is that your calibration algorithm should take into account the worst or the most sensitive pricing measure when sort of deciding what calibration to do and how much truncation to do. On a more sort of general thing, more sort of general point, I'm very interested to talk to anyone who's sort of got a computer science or sort of optimization background or whatever, and are sort of interested in trying to get some of these codes into some sort of, you know, publicly accessible sort of domain that quants can use. So I think, you know, that there's a lot of scope there for developing new quant libraries that have more sophisticated optimization algorithms. And there are all sorts of interesting sort of future directions which I'm happy to talk about. And obviously, I made a promise on the talk page, you know, and I asked you at the beginning of the talk, you know, we're not in stable times anymore, you know. I gave this, well, most of this research was done when the market was much better. I've had a look at the forward curve and how much they've moved across, you know, precious metals, nickel, all that sort of stuff, natural gas, and there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of market dislocation, there's a lot of volatility surface is skewing in ways that we've never seen before. And the question now is, how can we capture that? You know, do these models really capture that? And I think that's sort of something to think about, and sort of how going forward can we change either data analysis or the data sort of, how can we work with the data in some way to get some more meaningful measure of how sort of how the hectic markets are really affecting price, and whether the model is resistant to that sort of, you know, to hectic sort of times of market dislocation. So if you're sort of into stats, you might sort of know about these things already. If you're not, then you might know about these things anyway. But I don't think that we're in this sort of market dislocation just for until tomorrow. It's going to be a while, and we have to sort of look at models in a new light. And with that, it's a brilliant time. Okay, this is a really exciting time for quants, for anyone doing this stuff, because there's just huge holes in the model. The data isn't there. They're trying to make predictions. Banks are trying to make all their methodology predictions based on the 1 in 5,000 year event. They don't have data going back to the Bronze Age. You know, how do you do that? And so the problem is it's a real question of how you make some sort of, how you take a defensible position on this model. It doesn't have to be wrong or right, but it has to be defensible. And I think that's the most important thing that the quant community is facing right now, defending these things, and not saying, well, I don't know, I used to work in a physics lab, and I thought it would, you know, it would look good in the bank. And so how do we defend these things? How do we put in quality measures as part of the model validation routines? And a big part of that's calibration, okay? That's the part that most quantitatives don't want to go there. You know, calibration, I just put it in the black box, gives me numbers. That's where I think the opportunities are. And so that's my talk. Okay. Thanks.
Shall we open it to two questions though? I mean, people tend to start taking food in.
Yeah. Sort
of, if there are any questions, I think just ask them, I guess. Any sort of, you know, formal questions? Then I guess you can ask them informally, you know.
Yeah.
You can just ask about informally.